So another question to you. Presently in Bangladesh, some of the clinical cases we found in Delhi cause, after 1 or 2 days of infection, adult becomes hard and very swollen and very hard. And you, if you give hot fomentation or cold fomentation, nothing works there. So in India, usually what you do for hard and swollen adult in case of clinical mastitis?
Okay, you know, as you know, when I was discussing about clinical, you know, how to handle clinical cases of mastitis, there I had mentioned that, you know, speed at which you attend to acute case of mastitis immediately after parturition is extremely important. And most of them are, you know, because of environmental infection, picked up, you know, environmental infection like, you know, Pseudomonas, Staphylococcus and E. coli. Problem, you know, with the staph is, you know, very acute because staph is an intracellular bacteria. And therefore, anything which you are giving as a drug has to reach inside the cell and, you know, kill the bacteria because they are hiding over there. So you will find, you know, the abscesses and other kinds of things, you know, with staphylococci becomes, you know, very chronic. And even in Western countries, if they find that it is staphylococci, this, they, you know, usually cull this animal. They don't want to keep on, you know, trying, you know, with drugs. What I usually tell the, you know, vets over here in case of acute mastitis is that, you know, you need to also administer anti-inflammatory drugs as well as antihistamine, because it is the huge inflammation resulting in fibrosis. You know, the hard odor is not because of inflammation, but it is because of rapid fibrosis, which is a natural defense mechanism to arrest the infection, you know, heavy load of infection which is there in the alveoli. And once there is fibrosis, it is very difficult to, you know, remove the fibrous material from there. So, you know, usually such animals are, you know, killed. And we do have around, you know, 5-6% of such cases where the, you know, the cotter goes off, you know, it gets fibrous and it becomes very hard, and it, you know, you cannot rescue it. But, you know, acting very rapidly for clinical mastitis cases and first administration of, you know, first injection to be given as intravenous injection is extremely critical here, because many of these cases are also toxic cases, you know, because the staph and, you know, E. coli will also release toxins. So there is also underlying toxemia, and there the absorption of antibiotic given intramuscular or subcut is going to be slightly delayed. So don't depend on an intramuscular injection, give intravenous injection and then follow it up properly, because every antibiotic has got a half-life. So if it says every 12 hours to be given, you know, you ask them to give every 12 hours for two to three days. And, you know, my own experience, of course, you know, I have got, you know, evidence from the cases which I treat. We have almost abundant oxytetracycline, you know, from our repository. But I usually treat these cases with, you know, oxytetracycline terramycin injection initially intravenously, you know, 30 to 50 ml diluted in 5% dextrose, and then another injection intravenous after 12 hours, followed by, you know, 3 intramuscular injection or maybe 1 LA injection later on. So that is how I usually treat them. But still you'll find, you know, few cases which will get fibrosis and nothing can be done, unfortunately.
Okay. Thank you. Before asking the last question, sorry, Mizan bhai, last question.
No problem.
I thank you so much for your nice deliberation. My last question is to, in case of dry cryotherapy or physical barrier or cryotherapy with long-acting antibiotics. So there are so many pros and cons of dry cryotherapy using long-acting antimicrobials. Yeah. So if there is already existing infection in the udder, so in that case, if we use the physical barrier only, so what will be the consequences, or what's your opinion in that case? So
I'm very happy you asked me this question, you know. I'm very happy. You see, even in case of dry cow therapy, we have got we have developed two formulations. There is one formulation which will release antibiotic for, say, you know, 5 days. It's a slow release, 5 days release antibiotic, which is, you know, constituted along with this, you know, physical barrier. So there, if you feel that there is a case, you know, which has suffered from mastitis, and you know, you feel that you have not been able to treat, you know, totally treat this, you know, from the infection, then in that case you can use our other product, which is containing, you know, neomycin or other antibiotic. And if you feel that, you know, there is no need of antibiotic there, you want to just use as a seal, then you can also use that product as a seal. So the choice lies with you.
Okay, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Tohid. Thank you very much for your questions. Dr. Divendra Vishwas.
Many thanks, Dr. Fuzan Abdul Ahmad. I have shared something with you, but in doing my practice, I found some HEPA, adult HEPA, but the continuous, the milk is let down. But she's not pregnant.
She's not pregnant,
but just adult HEPA, what two or three times she comes in stress, but not in surface, but not in pregnant, but always milk is let down. I got three cases in my experience at the time. Another consequence, another question, just I first time I asked the question. After the mastitis, sometimes I found that the one or two teeth is blocked. That means sometimes in near to the udder and teeth, there are some ball-like structures in here, yeah. And total udder is blocked. But I cannot cure that cases. So it is the one thing. And another thing is asked by
I think, Dibet, you can ask one by one. You have already two. Okay, I think Professor Samad sir can answer to us.
Okay, this two. I have one question about another. So if I actually want to share that.
I'll answer your two questions first. Why heifer? You know, there are men who have been found to secrete milk, you know. There are cases reported where, you know, boys and men were, you know, secreting milk.
Yeah.
And that is because of you know, simply, you know, milk synthesis is a function of prolactin.
Right.
Okay. And you know, as soon as prolactin is secreted, you know, you'll get milk synthesis will start. If there is also sensitization of udder with, you know, other hormones, you know? So it's not merely, you know, prolactin, but, you know, prolactin and other sensitization, like, you know, estrogen and then, you know, progesterone. You know, it's a, you know, combination of hormones effect. So if that is happening, then, you know, you may have, you know, this kind of, you know, issue. There are also tumors, you know, pituitary tumors, which are, you know, prolactin secreting tumors, which have been reported even in animals, and those will also increase, you know, prolactin secretion. There is a drug in Europe, you know, which is available, which was available in the market, which is commonly used in human for this, you know, prolactin, you know, secreting tumors. And that is an antagonist of prolactin, and that is used. And there are a few papers which I have seen, you know, published in literature where they have used, you know, this kind of drug for high yielding cows, which are, you know, which are giving milk like, you know, 20 liters, 25 liters at the time, you know, you need to dry them off. You know, this is another problem which we have not discussed. That, you know, there are high yielding cows, there are, you know, pregnant, advanced pregnant, reaching dry off period, you want to give 60 days dry off period, and at that particular time they are already secreting 20 liters of milk. You reduce concentrate, but they are so overwhelmed with hormones that, you know, still there is secretion. So how to dry them off becomes, you know, another problem. There, you know, with 20 liters of milk in udder, you don't want to stop milking. Because if you stop milking, then there is chance that, you know, such a good cow, you know, will have mastitis. So in those cases, you know, people have used that kind of thing. That is number one. And the second question was about
the blockage of teeth.
Yeah, blockage of teeth. Yeah, so generally in India, this is quite common, and this is because of faulty milking practices where the milker is using thumb, and that's why you have damage there, and because of that damage there is litter formation, and then you get a plug. So there are teat slitters available here in India. So I think it should also be available in Bangladesh. So those are tweezer type. If you open it, two blades will get opened. So you have to insert that inside, gets blade open, and then you have to remove it with jerk, and then that block gets off, and then you have to remove it and put some cannula inside for say 3 to 5 days, so that again there is no plug formation. So this is what these surgery people over here or the vets over here are doing for that.
Yeah.
Okay. So next question, Professor Divendu. Another
question. In my experience, during my treatment of the clinical cases, especially in mastitis, first times the blood is calm and the milk is just curd. But sometimes it will be treated with the gentamicin and neomycin tube, intramammary tube. Sometimes it is cured, but maximum times it is not cured. But it is not possible every time to culture the organisms, or sensitivity is not possible. But why the sometimes, but maximum time it is not cured? But the history is that first time it's bloody color milk is come out. And after 2 or 3 days, the total order is hard, and the production is not continue until it's live. I don't know why.
I have attended to lots of these cases of hemogalaxia. So the approach in hemogalaxia should be the first question to ask to the farmer is blood present only in one quarter milk, or it is in all quarters. Okay, now if it is present in all quarters, it is systemic. It is not infection of the udder. Okay, and usually in my practice, I have seen those are all because of severe hypocalcemia, where the calcium level has gone down to below 6 mg/dL, and you simply give calcium borogluconate, and next milking you find milk is totally clear. Okay. That is one approach where all from all quarters you are getting. Another test to do there is you collect milk in a vial, keep it for 15-20 minutes, and if blood cells are settling down, it is whole blood. Okay, and if it is not settling down and still it is chocolate colored, then it is hemolytic. So if it is hemolytic, it is because of hemolytic syndrome, maybe due to Babesia, thylaria or other organisms, which are rupturing RBCs, and the released hemoglobin is now finding way through milk, we get in urine. So sometimes even in these cases, you will get, hemogalaxia, which is hemoglobinogalaxia. I mean, it's a hemoglobin and not blood. So I think, this will solve, most of the problems, if it is coming in all the quarters. Now, if it is coming only from one quarter, then again, what I will do, I'll take the milk, and if centrifuge is available, fine. If you are not having centrifuge handy over there, just keep it for 10-15 minutes and see for settling down of the cells. If you find that it's getting clouded on the bottom because of settling of the red blood cells and white blood cells, then in that case it is diapedesis. Okay, the cells are coming out of the capillaries into milk, and that usually tells you about some physical phenomenon, and it may not be an infection. So hemogalaxia cases, do not consider them to be an infective cases. They may be nutritive or physical trauma cases. Maybe local injury, another cow has hit very hard to one quarter, and that blood is coming in the other.
Okay, thank you very much.
Even in hypocalcemic,
okay, thank you.
Even in hypocalcemic, even in hypocalcemic cases, what I tell to the vet is collect 5 ml blood in a vial without any anticoagulant, just keep it like that, and allow it to clot. If it doesn't clot in 12 minutes, then it is hypocalcemia, because calcium is required for clotting. And to confirm whether it is because of calcium, just put one drop of calcium borogluconate which you have, and if it gets clot, it is because of hypocalcemia.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Samad, for sharing this knowledge with us. Thank you, everybody.
Okay, sir. Now I have another question. It is one participant asking, if some area is flood affected or more flood prone, what will be your advice to build the house for the farm in a flood prone area?
In a flood prone, you're talking of remaining flooded for a larger period of the year.
Yes, sir. Yeah, maybe yes.
Now, in that case, there is no other option but to raise the platform,
Okay.
Okay, fill it up and raise the platform to a level where, the water will not enter, because, having, water all the time is going to be, problematic. If it is getting accumulated and remaining there, if it is there for, certain period of time and getting cleared off, then there is no issue. I usually handle farms where, near Bombay and Pune area, where there is a lot of flooding takes place. Even in Bombay, flooding is very common. So if flooding is for a very brief period of time, generally there is no problem. But with earthen floor, only the problem will come that you need to maintain it quite often, compared to the concrete flooring. Concrete flooring doesn't require continuous maintenance. Eroded with small areas, eroded areas, which we call as bird's nest, and that is the area where you will have water and you will have dung and urine, and then animal will sit and that becomes a source of infection. So maintenance of flooring is extremely important, and it will depend on area to area.
Okay,
For good health of the animal, what is required is dryness. Keep that in mind, that you want to keep your floor dry, you want to keep environment not too humid, and you want to keep environment well ventilated. Then you don't need. Otherwise, what you do is you create artificial walls. Then there is no air flowing, so then you put fan, additional fan. You have put a physical barrier. Now you want to put fan and flow. And then if that is not enough, then put foggers. You do all these kinds of things, which is very energy expensive and not really suitable for our farmers. So I think institutes need to take up, especially livestock production department needs to take up, animal housing as an important area of investigation and development, and develop suitable models, worth say 5,000 taka, 10,000 taka, or 25,000 taka. Somebody who wants to build Taj Mahal, let him build Taj Mahal. You should be prepared to build Taj Mahal also for him. But if somebody is not having that much of money, wants to invest in a good housing which is more comfortable for cows, you also develop that model. Another thing which I tell usually to farmers is you want to create a housing which looks good to you. But that is not true. It should look good to the cow. It should ensure the cow comfort. There was a chief minister here, and his secretary came to me that he wants to develop a farm, and then I told him this farm should be like this. You can have this is chief minister's farm. How can you say use bamboo and have a house like this? I said chief minister is not going to stay there. It is the cow which is going to stay there. So it has to be comfortable to cow. So keep that in mind, that all those which you the housing which you are developing is ensuring the basic principles of cow comfort and not beauty to your eyes.
Okay, sir, thank you. Sir, in Bangladesh we see that on the concrete floor, over the concrete floor, farmers sometimes use rubber mattress. And one of our study you have seen that with the farmers who are using the rubber mattress, the somatic cell count is higher. So what is your experience with this, with the rubber mattress in India?
Yeah. You see, whether a farm is having mastitis problem or not, I enter in the farm and can tell the farmer whether he has cases of mastitis. And there are two criteria I look at. Number one, is he using cement concrete with rubber flooring? Number one. And number two, whether he is washing floor and washing the animals, he is using how much of water. The more water he uses, more cases of mastitis. Less water he will use, less mastitis cases. So even if it is cement concrete floor, I tell him not to wash, just remove dung, scrape it. You need scrapers, you know. So scrape it, you know, with your hand manually and let it dry. Over a period of time, even on cement concrete floor, you'll get a carpet type of, you know, dried dung, which is very comfortable for the, you know, for the animal. So, but if you are using, you know, anything which is keeping it, you know, wet, then it is going to lead to mastitis cases. Now, when you use rubber mats, it is not absorbent. Okay, it is only cushioning. So it is not going to keep, you know, floor dry. On the contrary, you know, all, you know, dung will be retained, urine will be retained. So for a longer period of time, you know, now it is going to be, you know, going to remain, you know, humid and wet.
One more problem
with, you know, rubber mat is if it is not properly laid, even from corner to corner, you will end up with problem of tick infestation. I have seen very big farms, you know, here, 2,000 cows, 2,500 cows, you know, I mean, like, you know, IT, you know, postgraduates, you know, very, very much, you know, technology driven. They want to, you know, use all these new technologies, you know, they end up with, you know, without application of mind, they end up using this. And then one fine morning, I got a call that, you know, they are having this problem that, you know, about, you know, 30% cases are having thylidiasis. I said, you know, look for tick. He said, there are no ticks. I said, are you using rubber mat? He said, yes. I said, no, rip off one rubber mat and see, you know, what is there. They ripped off and saw millions of, you know, ticks which were, you know, getting, you know, bred under the, you know, rubber mat. So if you are able to take care of these things, I don't have anything against rubber mat. But then if you are using rubber mat, then, you know, be sure in mind that it's not going to be dry. Then you are not washing, you know, animal. The problem is you use rubber mat and then you want to wash animals on the rubber mat. So then it remains, you know, wet for a very long period of time, and then you unnecessarily use a lot of water.